together.
Well, I'm so excited to be here with you all today at our North San Jose campus, our Sunnyvale campus, South San Jose. Those of you watching us online today, we are continuing the series that we've been going through. We're calling it My Not So Perfect Family, and we got a special topic for you all today, and I'm thrilled to be able to share it with you. Today, we're going to talk about this great search that all of humanity has been on at one point in their lives or another. Right? It's the search that leads us to get into credit card debt over meals and experiences that we can't afford. It's the search that allows us to stalk people on social media and still be kind of acceptable in our culture. It's the search that makes us all of a sudden get really creative and write poetry and make cards and scrapbooking. It's the search for bae. Now, bae is not a term you might be familiar with. And it's honestly not a term that I would personally use. It's something that our dearly beloved creative team told me is hilarious, it's relevant, it's current. So let's take a look together at what the Urban Dictionary defines as bae. It says, it is a word used by people to address their significant others because they have found themselves too lazy to pronounce the entire word babe. All right, now that's not a word that you're gonna find in the Bible or in Scripture. However, there is something out there that I think is relevant for each of us to know, and it's called the Ten Commandments of Bae. Now, I wanna list them off to you guys because we're gonna touch on some of them because they're hilarious and they're relevant for all of our lives, no matter if you're dating, you're single, or you're married. So here we go. Number one, God is the bae above all other bays. Number two, Bible over bae every day. Number three, bae can't stay if bae only plays. Number four, guard your heart. All right, number five, there is no delay on the way to bae. Number six, singleness is not a struggle. Number seven, don't lay with bae until your wedding day. Number eight, bae needs boundaries. Number nine, bae ain't bae if bae don't pray. And number 10, bae ain't bae just for today. Now, these commandments apply for all of us, right? I think all of us, no matter where we found ourselves in our relationship, can take away something from this. You can find these online. But whether you're looking for your bae, or you're sitting next to your bae, or maybe you're married to your bae, there's something in this talk today for all of us. In fact, I remember a few years ago, my wife and I, Jasmine, we read this book together when we were dating, and I kid you not, the very first sentence in the first chapter of this book, the author said, if you're reading this, chances are you're either in a relationship or know someone who is. Wow, would include all of humanity to market your book to. But there you go. There's something in this for all of us. All right, so let's take a quick survey across all of our campuses, North San Jose, Sunnyvale, South San Jose. I want to get a quick show of hands and we're going to engage in this together. Who here has been married for 20 or more years? 20 plus years? 20 plus years in the room, all right. Anybody been married for 10 or more years? 10 or more years, raise your hands. All right, I see you guys, 10 or more years. Okay, 5 years or more. He's been married 5 years or more. There's a few here in the room. Okay, how about our newlyweds? Where are the newlyweds at in the room? Any newlyweds? All right, now where are all the single people at? Single people, raise your hands. All right, take a look around, single people. Take a look around. You're welcome. All right, saved you a little bit of heartache right here, a little bit of a head start. But there's something in here that we can all take away because relationships are not just for today, they're not just for singleness, they're for married and for the rest of our lives, and all of us have to deal with this. So as we're tackling this topic today, I'm going to be sharing a little bit about my former love life and the short-lived love life that I had, at least in my dating life. But also we're going to ultimately look at what the Bible has to say about all of this. But all of us have that story, right? All of us had that time in our lives where we're in high school maybe, and we're like, I found the one I'm going to be with forever. And all of us have been at that place. And for me, it happened my senior year of high school. I started dating this girl. It was a long-distance relationship, but it was a girl that I had known pretty much my whole childhood. Our families knew each other really well. We grew up in the same church together. We had a ton of things in common. We had similar interests. Her dad was French, her mom was American, just like my family. And we grew up together. And in all of this, it felt like so much of our lives were in alignment, so much of us were in common, that it was almost God ordained that we would be together. And I truly believed that I was going to be with her for the rest of my life. And then, one fateful night, I get a phone call, and she decides to break off what God himself had ordained, right? At least in my own mind, that's what I thought. So what went wrong, right? What went wrong at that time? Because we could go into a whole philosophical discussion about my former love life, right? Whether or not we were just too young and immature, or whether the long distance was too difficult, whether maybe we loved each other unequally, or whether she was just disobeying God. I mean, I'm just kidding about that. Obviously, that wasn't the case. I hope you're not watching online if you're here with us. But at the core, what I truly believe happened is that I put the priority of my life around this relationship. I made it the foundation for my life, and I added all this weight to it, and at the core of it, it broke, because I was adding weight to the relationship that it was not meant to support. It couldn't carry it. See, my whole life's priority had been a relationship, and I had no experience. I had no relationship experience. I had no wisdom around this. I had nobody to speak into me with this. I had no foundation. And when I piled on the weight of my life on it, it crumbled, it broke it, and it broke me. See, every relationship has weight to it, right? Every relationship that we enter in, we're adding a type of significance to it, whether it's the weight of our expectations for one another, the weight of our baggage from our past, the weight of our time and our energy, the weight of our emotions that get invested in it. And on top of all those things that I pile on, I added the big fat weight of the expectation of a future marriage. And then it crumbled. And that applies for all relationships, right? If you're single, you're dating, or you're married, all relationships have weight, and what we build them on makes a huge difference. And what I realized at that time, as a result of that relationship, is that things that you have in common, right, similarities in people, is no real foundation for a healthy relationship. It's no foundation. And so today we're going to talk about how we build that foundation for ourselves so that we can have relationships where we win at life. And so we're going to make three choices together is what we're going to be uncovering. We're going to talk about three choices that we can do and take to win with what matters most in our relationship. So if you're taking notes today, the first choice that we're going to make is we're going to choose becoming over searching. We're going to choose becoming over searching. Here's what I mean by that. I mean that instead of searching for your bae, we're going to focus on becoming bae for someone else. Instead of searching for someone, how about you become the one for somebody else? And we're going to take a look today in a passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 6. And this is a story of Jesus, and he's teaching to a crowd. It's one of his most famous sermons called the Sermon on the Mount. And at the end of the passage, he has some really, really important topics for us to uncover that I really think brings clarity around what matters most in life. If you're following along, you can follow on our screens or you're on your Bible apps with me. Matthew chapter 6, verse 31 through 34. He says this, "So do not consume yourselves with questions. What will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? Outsiders make themselves frantic over such questions. They don't realize that your heavenly Father knows exactly what you need." Now pause here for a second. I was reflecting on this first half a couple weeks ago, and I was thinking, man, those three questions, that's like what my wife asked me on every date night. "Hey, honey, what are you going to wear tonight? What should we go eat?" Now my answer is going to be, "My love, our Heavenly Father knows everything that we need." So there you go. There's one for you for your next date night. But here's the most important part in this passage as we digress. Verse 33, it says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and righteousness, and all of these things will be given to you. So do not worry about tomorrow. Let tomorrow worry about itself. Living faithfully is large enough of a task for today." He's saying, Don't worry, because God knows all that you need. Earlier, even in the passage, Jesus is talking about how he provides even for the birds who are in the air and the flowers in the fields, and how much more your Heavenly Father, who loves you as his children, how much more will he care for you? And yet, with so many areas of our lives, including relationships, we worry. And we worry that we're not going to be able to get what we deserve. And here's what Jesus is saying in this. He says, stop worrying about being provided for, but start shifting your focus on your priorities. Stop worrying about provision and start focusing on your priorities. Really, our focus is the primary thing that we actually have control over in our lives. There's so many things that are out of our hands. There's so many, especially in relationships, we can't read each other's minds. There's so many things that are out of our hands, but our focus is something that is ours to own. And what Jesus says is our focus should be to seek God first, his kingdom, his righteousness, and everything else will come in its time. In the words of the first commandment of Bay, God is the bay above every other bay. God is the one who we should be seeking first. Jesus is saying that when we make God our priority and the focus of our attention, everything else that we're seeking and that we desire and that we worry about, all these things will come into alignment. All these things will be taken care of as a byproduct of our right focus. That Jesus himself, our focus in God, is the foundation for our lives. Now, when I think about my life and my foundation, I think about it in concentric circles. And the first thing that shapes the center of who I am and my foundation is my faith. So we have these graphics are up on the screen, and they'll show you that the center is my faith, and my faith in turn will shape my values. My values shape what I prioritize in life and what I see as most important. And my priorities determine the way that I behave and the way that I live my life. And so what you place your faith in becomes the foundation and the start for everything that you value and the way that you live. If you're not placing your faith in God, you're placing your faith in something else. All of us believe in something, and all of us are placing our faith in something. And if it's not in God, maybe it's in your job, in your career, in your education, in your current relationship, in your abilities, in your intellect. All these things are things that we place our faith in. But the challenge with this is that all of those, at one point or another, are going to fail. All of them have shortcomings because all of them are imperfect. None of us are perfect in our own abilities. No relationship is perfect. No job career is made in heaven. None of them are perfect. And think about how crucial it is to place your foundation, the faith, the center of your life on something that has the possibility to let you down. I think about every regret that I've ever had in my life. They were all because I placed my identity, my foundation, in something that wasn't meant to support it. Just like relationships. You see, placing your faith in God is the only assurance of a good foundation. It's the only way that we can know for sure that our lives can be built on something that will last forever. See, God is the only one who never fails. He's the only one who is always true, who's always faithful, whose love is never ending for every single one of us. And think about how much more powerful it is for us to build our life on something like this. Think about how much more powerful it is for us to live our life founded on God, the creator of the universe, knowing that now we can step into confidence. Confidence knowing that we are loved by God himself. We can step with greater purpose knowing that he has called us for something that is far greater than ourselves. We can live with a greater perspective on life, knowing that we live today in light of all of eternity. Knowing that we can live today with joy and with celebration because our past is behind us. We have been forgiven, and we can step today knowing that he has taken away our mistakes and we can live fully in him. Now, that's the kind of person that I want to be with. That's the kind of person that I want to be for myself. Somebody who has confidence. Somebody who lives with purpose. Somebody who has a greater perspective on all of life. Somebody who has contagious joy and who celebrates life because they know that they have been forgiven. That's the kind of person that I don't want to be with. And that's the kind of person that I want to be for myself. See, only by placing God at the center can you become bay for someone else. So stop worrying about finding somebody, but start focusing on the things that matter most, your relationship with God. Now, let's sidestep a little bit. I want to invite you and continue in the story of my love life. So act number two. In fall of 2007 is when I met the lovely Jasmine. Spoiler alert, we get married. We met at San Jose State University. And honestly, we had relatively nothing in common. She and her family is very different from my family, had a very different upbringing. We had different tastes in almost everything, food, music, hobbies, interests, all of that. She was easygoing, great to get along with. People trust her really easily and share things with her. And I was pretty awkward, to be honest. I even have a picture to show, kind of to show you one of our first dates together. There she is. Beautiful, and look at that mop on my head. By the grace of God, I mean, if there's any evidence of the grace of God, this is it right there. So she loves creative arts. She does pottery. She's really good at pottery. You should check out her stuff. I like the outdoors. I like beer. She likes wine. I drink coffee. She drinks tea. The list goes on. Anyways, I don't think there's any algorithm that would have ever put us together out there, right? But one summer, we hit it off, right? We met, we were part of this college ministry together at San Jose State. We started serving together. We were on the leadership team together. That summer, we started talking, we started hanging out. I helped her move. Then for my birthday, she took me to go do pottery with her because that's one of her passions. She took me on my birthday, and we had that moment. I don't know if you guys have seen the movie Ghost with Patrick Swayze, where our hands kind of came together. Except she was Patrick Swayze in that one. And man, that was it. I was like, I got this. And so a few years went by, right? And we determined the relationship, DTR, as it's called. And one thing was clear to us. There's one thing that stood out, even as I was reflecting back on my life, and I never realized how crucial this moment was for our relationship. And I'm so grateful to God that we started off this way, because this changed everything for us. We made a decision that our faith was going to become the foundation, and the purpose of our relationship will be to seek God first, whatever the outcome may be. All right, I'm going to repeat this for you, because I don't want you to miss this. Our faith was going to become the foundation for our relationship, and the purpose for our relationship would be to seek God first, no matter what the outcome may be. Now, don't get me wrong. Our hope was to get married, right? We wanted to be together. We loved one another, and we wanted to see this last. But we took it as we felt God was leading us. And we decided that we were going to make that a priority in our life. Something that we used to always say is either we're getting married or this is going to become a growing experience for both of us. Because we didn't know. We didn't have clarity right away where God was going to be leading us. We wanted to take it as God led. By God's grace, 3 years later, we got married. And at our wedding, we shared the scripture, which I want to share with you all. It's in 1 John chapter 4, verse 16 through 17. 1 John chapter 4, it says, "We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in his love. God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect." You see, Jasmine and I have placed our faith in what he says. And if we really believe this scripture to be true, that means that the best way for us to keep on growing together in our relationship with one another and our love for one another was to place God at the center and as the focus for our lives. Now, I have another graphic I want to show you guys, and it's a triangle. It's geometry week at South Bay Church. We started with circles, now we're going with triangles. And this is a triangle. So you'll see on the left, you got yourself, it's me. And on the right, you got your bae. And at the top, you have God. And as we're both choosing to make God our priority and our focus, we're both growing together towards him. We're also growing closer to one another. That's what this passage is saying right here. That when we choose to seek God first, not only are we growing towards him, but we're growing closer to one another. But that only happens if both of us make that decision. Both of us have to make the decision to grow towards God, to seek Him first. If only one of us is moving in that direction, the gap becomes greater. We want to be moving together towards God. If we're not in alignment with our faith and our values and our priorities, we can't grow closer into what God desires for every single one of us. You see, it takes more than just making our faith. It just takes a lot more than just saying we value our faith or that God is our foundation. It takes both of us working together towards it. In the words of the ninth commandment of Bay, Bay ain't Bay if Bay don't pray. We both have to have the same values. You've got to have alignment in what matters most in life. If your faith really is central to what you do and who you are and is the foundation for your life, don't try and entangle yourself and connect with somebody on an intimate level who shares a different set of values or a different faith than you do. It'll lead you to unnecessary pain. Now, that's a lot easier said than done for some of us here in this room. Maybe you're here in the room and you're with someone whose values or his faith doesn't match up with yours. Maybe you're even married to somebody who has a different faith than yours. Now, if you're dating, I want to tell you, you need to make a decision today about what matters most in your life. What do you want your life to be built on? Especially if you are a follower of Jesus, you gotta pray to Him and seek His will for your life and see what He wants you to do, because you have a decision to make. Ask people who you care about, people who care about you, who share in your values and your faith, who can speak into your life and show you what's best for you. If you're married, and you're in this situation where somebody shares a different set of values than you do and a different faith, unless you're in an abusive relationship, I truly believe that God wants your marriage to succeed with all my heart. And you need to pray for your own heart and for your spouse's. And you gotta pray that God will allow you to love your spouse with so much affection that it will be a reflection of God's love for them. You gotta love Him with a passion that God has for every single one of us, that you would find community and people to pray alongside you, join a life group, get with people who can help carry the burden alongside you to pray for you and to see your marriage through and to see it succeed. But for those of you who are single in the room, this is your opportunity. Don't compromise on what you believe to be true. I've seen so many of my friends compromising their faith and their values because they chose to make a relationship a priority. I've had close friends of mine leave church, change what they believe, even start behaving in ways that they use to condemn. And they did it all because they chose to make a relationship a priority over what they believe to be true. And that's easier said than done, right, in life, to say that we believe something or we have placed our foundation on something. And there's no greater temptation and test to it than our own human desire, right? The desire to want more, the desire to connect with human connection, the desire to be loved by somebody, the desire to belong. But desire without the right focus almost always leads to disappointment. And so the choice that we're going to make today is we're going to choose values over desire. So we're going to choose becoming over searching. And now we're going to choose our values over our desire. With relationships, so often we let emotions and passion cloud our judgment. We don't see clearly when we're emotionally entangled in something. My dad had this saying he would tell me. It's in French, but I'm going to translate it for you guys. My dad had this saying that he would tell me when I was in that relationship. He said, when your heart is in flames, you got smoke that rises and blinds you. It's a lot more poetic in French, believe me, but he says, when your heart's on fire, when your heart is in flames, you got smoke that rises and blinds your eyes. See, when we have passion and emotion, a lot of time we're blinded to see what is really true. And we don't get to see with real focus the things that matter most in life. When we don't start with the right focus, we lose sight of what matters most. When we don't start with the right focus, we lose sight of what matters most. Now, let me give you a scenario really quick. Now, a personal conviction that I have and a belief that I am absolutely convinced of, I believe that God wants sex to be something that is reserved for marriage. Now, I don't just believe that because that's something that I see in Scripture and because I believe God wants what's best for me. Even outside of all that, right, I see the kind of bond emotionally and physically that sex creates. And when I see that kind of bond it creates, it requires an equally important commitment for one another. Not only that, but I see the risks that come from it are way too high for short-term pleasure and short-term self-gratification. And when I come into a relationship with somebody who would have a different set of values than I do in that area, I will most likely compromise. I will most likely compromise that thing because then my values take a back seat because I have chosen to entangle myself with somebody who has different values than I do. So that means my faith is now secondary. So my values, my lifestyle change, my behavior, and my integrity has now been lost. Because let's be honest, especially with sex, it's a lot easier to have sex than not to have sex when you're in a relationship with somebody. And ultimately, I want my values to determine my relationship, not the other way around. I don't want my relationship to tell me what I'm supposed to do. I want my values and who my foundation is built on to determine the way that I lead my life. And so for those of you who are single in the room, decide what you value today. What will be first in your life? And do so before the smoke rises and blinds you to see what is true. It's easier to set your priorities while you're single than when you're entangled and connected with somebody who has conflicting values. So we're going to make three choices today. We're going to choose becoming over searching. We're going to choose our values over our desire. And lastly, we're going to choose intentionality over ambiguity. See, I think we spend so much time in the search for our bae, and that we forget what we're supposed to do once we've found our bae. And when it comes to relationships, the costs are way too high to leave up to ambiguity. There's so much of ourselves that gets invested in them. Right, we give of ourselves and our hearts and our souls to people when we engage in relationships. And with that intention, with that clarity, it leads to unnecessary pain. The author and pastor Jefferson Bethke said this. He says, dating without the intent of marriage is like going to the grocery store with no money. You either leave unhappy or you take something that isn't yours. I'm going to say this again. Dating without the intent of marriage is like going to the grocery store with no money. You either leave unhappy or you end up taking something that isn't yours. In the words of the last commandment of bae, bae ain't bae just for today. We're going to lead with intention, not just for today, but for the rest of our lives. In every relationship, we share a piece of ourselves with one another. We share a piece, and the more intimate the relationship, the closer the bond, the more it hurts when it doesn't work out. This is something I actually learned in school. At San Jose State, I wasn't a great student. I wasn't paying attention in everything, but this is something that stood out to me. This passage right here, this principle from interpersonal communications course. And our professor taught this principle called self-disclosure. And the principle of self-disclosure says that the more you share of yourself with another person, the more intimate the relationship, the greater the bond. I'll say this again. The more you share of yourself with another person, the more intimate the relationship, the greater the bond. Now, that seems pretty simple and basic. But I think that happens on multiple levels. It happens emotionally. It happens as we share with one another spiritually. And it comes as we share of one another physically. And that's why breakups hurt so much. The longer you've been together, the more of your heart has been given over to someone. And the more intimate you've been, the more of yourself is now with the other person. I think about it kind of like a fruit. If I had an apple with me right here, and my fruit was a representation of my heart. And every time I entered in a relationship and I was intimate with somebody, I offered for them to take a bite out of it. And every relationship that I choose to go into, every single person gets to take a bite out of it. And the more I've done so, the less of it is left for the person that God intended me for me to be with. There's a passage in Proverbs chapter 4 that maybe a lot of you have heard before. Proverbs 4:23, it says, above all else, watch over your heart, diligently guard it, because from a sincere and pure heart come the good thing and noble things of life. Now, this is something we hear often in churches, right? Guard your heart, right? But what does that mean for us practically? Guard your heart. It means don't waste your time with ambiguity and lead your life not knowing where this is heading, but make God your focus and search for him first and make marriage your intent in your relationship. It means don't get ahead of yourself, just like I did, and on the first day decide that you're going to marry this person when you're not really sure where God is leading you. It means don't start naming your future kids on your second date. For ladies out there, don't buy your wedding dress until he's given you a ring. It means set good boundaries for your life so that you're not going into unnecessary pain. It means find people who can keep you accountable to it, who can support you and encourage you in your relationship. It means having meaningful conversations about our future and where God wants us to go. It means that we're inviting people into our life to speak into it, people who we care about, people who can mentor us, who can speak into our relationship. It means to pray together. Prayer reveals so much about the content of our hearts. It means that we're going to choose to grow together. Now we're going to read books and we're going to seek God and we're going to choose to take steps forward in alignment with God's will. That's what it means to grow together and to guard our hearts. But some of us, we're still thinking about that fruit. And you're thinking, man, how many people have taken a bite out of this? And how much of it is left now? And who's going to want what's left of my fruit? Who's going to want what's left of my heart? And most of us have been broken. And most of us have had pieces of our hearts taken away from us. And this is a reality for everybody, whether you're single or you're dating or you're married. All of us have been broken. And all of us at one point have felt worthless. We felt like our baggage is unforgivable. We have all these mistakes and all these hurts and all this brokenness and all these emotions. And who would want all of that? And the hope that we all have today is that Jesus wants that. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says, God made Christ, who had never sinned, to be an offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ Jesus. It says that he took on our baggage, our sin, our mistakes, our brokenness, that he died for it, even though he was perfect, so that we could have relationship with him, so that we could be made whole, so that we could go from brokenness to wholeness. Even earlier in the passage, it says that anybody who is in Christ, anybody who has made their priority and their focus in Jesus can become a new person. That the old core is gone, but the new has come. That's why we place our focus and our foundation in him. That's why we make him our priority. That's how we can move from brokenness into wholeness. That's how we can move from pain and sickness into healing. That's how we can move from insecurity into confidence. He's the hope upon which we stand. That's why our lives are built upon him. That's why we're going to choose together as a church to choose becoming over searching. We're going to choose our values over our desire. And we're going to choose our intention over ambiguity. How differently will we live our lives today if we ask those questions? How differently will we approach our relationships if we knew that we were thinking about them in light of all of eternity, in light of marriage and what God has called us towards? How different would our relationships look like if we spend as much time investing time, resources, and energy into preparing for our marriages than we do into preparing to make our wedding days Instagrammable? Think about it. The amount of energy that we spend, what if we shifted our focus towards what God wants for us? That's when you can step in and live a life in relationships with confidence. That's how you can step in with a sense of purpose. That's how you can have a greater perspective on life and know that God has something that's greater for you in light of all of eternity. That's how you can live with joy and with celebration, knowing that God has forgiven you, that your past is behind you, and that he is making you new. And that's what God is calling every single one of us towards. And today, we're going to conclude our time by trusting him with this. Because now that we've understood what this means, we have to let go. And there's something that's counterintuitive when it comes to God, is that freedom in our lives only comes with surrender. We have to give ourselves up to be able to experience this freedom that he has for us, and we have to trust him. And so I'm going to invite you today to pray with us. And we have some prayer teams across all of our campuses. At our North San Jose and Sunnyvale campus, they'll be in the back to pray for you. At our South San Jose campus, you can join us in the front. But I'm going to invite you to join us as we worship with one more song, to come forward or to come and receive prayer. And you don't even have to say anything, but to say, I need to trust God with this area of my life. To believe that He has more for you than you even believe for yourself. And so we're going to pray together, and we're going to worship together, and we're going to allow Him to be the subject of our attention and our focus. Let's pray together today. God, I thank You that You are present, You are here in this room, and You are calling every single one of us to a purpose and a calling that is far greater than ourselves. And there's many here in the room, many of us here in the room, who need to place You as our focus. Some of us have been so focused on finding the one that we've stopped searching for becoming who You've called us to be. We've placed our attention in the things that weren't made to sustain the life and the foundation that You've called us to. Some of us, we need to receive forgiveness. Maybe we need to forgive someone who's hurt us or forgive ourselves in order to move on and step into who You've called us to be. Some of us here are married and we need new life breathed into our relationship. We need to allow You to move in our marriages, in our relationship, and allow the focus and our love for You breathe life into the love that we have for one another. And some of us, we need to start today by placing our focus and our attention in You for the first time, to trust You to be the foundation for our lives, to know that You are the provider, that You are the one who knows all things, that You are the one who loves us as far as the east is from the west, and that You have greater things in store for every single one of us. So God, we trust You today. We pray to You today. God, we implore that You move in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together and worship. And if you'd like to receive prayer, there's people in the back.